Hello viewer, a warm welcome to Elimu TV where you watch and learn. I am your teacher, Madam Christine Okot, taking you through biology, and today is our fourth lesson. So let us have a preview of what we're going to look at this lesson. So first we're going to review the previous assignment. Secondly, we're going to define the fungi kingdom. We're also going to look at examples of fungi, to look at the characteristics of organisms in fungi kingdom. And lastly, I'm going to give you an assignment. So let us start with the previous assignment. So we had two questions. Question number one was state and explain the main groups of protists. So here we have the three main groups we had discussed earlier in our third lesson. So we have the protozoans, which are animal-like protists. They resemble animals in the way they get their food. They are mostly unicellular. So these ones are heterotrophs because they cannot make their own food. Then the second type of the protist, we have the algae. So these ones are plant-like protist because they can photosynthesize or they can make their own food. Then the third type of protist, we have the fungus-like protist. This one, they decompose dead organisms, and like the fungi, so these ones, fungi-like protists, are able to move at some point in their life, and they do not have the chitin in their cell wall. Example, we have the slime molds, the water molds, and the downy mildew. Question number two was, what is the difference between aerobic and anaerobic respiration? You first have to know what respiration is before you proceed to define or to see that, to look at the difference between aerobic and anaerobic. So respiration is the breakdown of food particle using oxygen so that you can release energy. So we have the two types of while anaerobic respiration, oxygen is not needed in the process of breaking down food particles. Then part B of question two, which type of respiration do the protists undergo? We had learned earlier in our third lesson, the protists undergo aerobic respiration and facultative. So let us proceed and define the fungi. So these are organisms which comprise single-celled or multi-nucleated organisms that live by decomposing and absorbing the organic material in which they grow. So most of them are single-celled or others are multi-celled. They also have numerous nuclei and they live mainly by decomposing, that is eating dead decaying matter, and they absorb the organic materials in which they grow in. So we have examples of fungi that we commonly know. So these include the mushrooms. So some of the mushrooms, there are some which are eaten while there are some which are poisonous. We have molds that normally grow on bread. Then we have yeast. It's an agent normally used when we are preparing bread. So these are just among the few examples of organisms which are found in the fungi kingdom. So why is there a need to have a fungi kingdom while we can see that some of them resemble the plants? So first of all, the fungi cannot be classified under plants. One, because the fungi cells do not have the chloroplast, which the plants do. Then the fungus cells are heterotrophic, but plants are autotrophs. So the plants, they can synthesize their own food, while the fungi, they cannot. Then another difference why we cannot put them under the plant kingdom is the fungi cells, they what makes the cell wall, while fungi, they cannot be classified under in that they are both eukaryotic, that places fungi in its own kingdom because they do not photosynthesize. They do not have true roots and systems. Their cell walls are made of chitin. Then the cells are multi-nucleated. Proceeding on to the fungi, so these are just the major ways in which you can know or you can identify an organism belonging to the fungi kingdom. First, the cell type is eukaryotic. Then the cell walls, they contain chitin. The body type, it is either unicellular or multicellular. Nutrition is mostly by heterotrophic because they cannot make their own food. They are immobile, which means they cannot move around. So the common example, as we have stated, we have the mushroom, we have the yeast, We have the bread molds, we have the aster and the puffballs. So let us look at characteristics of fungi. So the first characteristic is some are unicellular like the yeast, while the others, which are multicellular like the toadstool, mushroom and the mold. So that is a structure of a yeast cell. You can see they are well defined nucleus. We have the cell wall, which is made of chitin. We have the cell membrane. We have the membrane bound organelles like the mitochondrium. We have the cytoplasm and we have the ribosome. So that is an example of a unicellular fungi, the cell structure. Then we have the mushroom, an example of multicellular fungi. So that's the first characteristic. Moving forward to the second characteristic of fungi, they are eukaryotic. That means they have a well-organized nuclear with nuclear envelope. They also have membrane-bound organelles. Looking at the structure of the yeast cell, you can see where you have the nuclear. It is well-defined and it has a nuclear envelope. The greenish part of our diagram there, that is where we find the nucleus. Then it has a membrane-bound organelle like the mitochondrium. So that makes it to be called a eukaryotic cell. Another characteristic of fungi is through their mode of feeding or the mode of nutrition. We can describe it as it undergoes three types of nutrition. They can either be decomposers, they can either be parasites, or they can all either be mutual symbionts. So if one is saprophytic, the fungi is saprophytic, it means the organism feed on dead or decaying organic matter. So they are mostly protists and fungi. So how do they feed? First of all, they will identify the item which they want to feed on. Then they secrete the enzymes on food. So that enzyme, it makes the food to become soft so that they can easily take in. Then they digest the food, they digest it externally. It's like, for example, we can relate this to, for example, if you want to take in a piece of bread, when you take it into the mouth, there is saliva there. The saliva will make the yeast to become soft. So that's the same way in which they secrete the enzymes on the food. Then when it's soft, it's very easy to digest the piece of food. So that is first the saprophytic nature of the fungi. Then next, they can either be parasitic. That means they absorb nutrients from the cells of the living host. When something is parasitic, it means it's going to get something out of a host. Then it leaves the host when it is harmed. Example of the parasitic fungi, we have the ones that infect the humans and the plants. All these are pathogenic. Then the next mode of nutrition is through mutual relationship. So the next type of relationship is the mutual relationship. So this is where both parties, they benefit. So the fungi, they absorb nutrients from the host organism, but they reciprocate with functions that benefit the partner in some way. So example, we have a fungi that is in the plants. So the plants may receive more water and nutrients. That is how the plants will benefit. While to the fungi receive photosynthetic product such as sugar from the plant. So that is a two-way relationship. Both of them have to benefit. While in parasitic, it's a one-way relationship. So those are the three main modes of feeding in the fungi kingdom. So the fourth characteristic of the fungi kingdom, some fungi are made up of a structural unit which are called the hyphae. They are especially present in the mold. So these are just like filament structures. So our illustration shows the hyphae. So the hyphae, they are filaments. They form a dense network of network which is known as mycelium. So a lot of the hyphae, they will make the mycelium, which will in turn make what we call the sporangiophore. When the sporangiophore form, they form what we call the sporangium. When they mature up and burst, they burst out as the spores, which are used in the process of reproduction in the yeast or in the fungi kingdom. The fifth characteristic is that the cell wall is made of chitin. So the plants also have a cell wall, but animals do not have. So this is one thing that makes a difference between the fungi and the animals. The fungi have a cell wall which is called chitin, while in the animals they do not have. So the body of the fungi is called as mycelium. So that is a thin tangle, it's just like the threads. Then the individual threads, like strands of cells, they're what we call the hyphae. Then the cell walls are normally made of chitin. This is a compound of carbohydrate. So our illustration shows the hyphae, the thread-like structures which are found in the bodies of the fungi. Then we have the mycelium and we have the sporangial sperms, which are mainly used in the process of reproduction. Another characteristic of the fungi is through the process of reproduction. So reproduction is by spore production. So, but there are some yeast which reproduce by the process we call budding. So in spore formation, this is a method, the fungi, they produce spores and the spores germinate and produce new plants. So the spore will come out when the sporangium has developed and matured up. When it bursts out, the spores, they germinate. So when they germinate, so this is like a type of reproduction. Other spores, other cells, other organisms will emerge from these spores which have germinated. Then another way in which they reproduce is by budding, especially in yeast. Our second illustration shows the formation of the process of budding. So it starts, the bud begins to form on a parent cell. So it's like a part which is protruding from the main cell. Then the nucleus will copy and divide. So the bud receives a copy. So it's like they split the nuclear information into two. Then the bud will now become a separate daughter cell. So this process goes on. The budding they reproduce through a chain of them will be made. So this process goes on from the beginning where there's just something which is protruding from the cell. The nuclear copy the material, then it goes on and on. Another characteristic of fungi, they store food in terms of glycogen or oil droplet. So glycogen is also known as the animal starch. It is formed when numerous glucose units condense to form a highly branched chain of glucose unit. The storage form of carbohydrates, this is a storage form in carbohydrates in animals and in fungi. So animals, they store, this glycogen is mainly stored in the liver and in the muscles. Now, why are these fungi important in our day-to-day activity or in our daily life? First of all, the saprophytic nature helps. It helps recycling nutrients in the environment and prevents the accumulation of dead plants and animals in the environment. We have discussed earlier saprophytes, and this is where they will feed on dead decaying matter. In the minerals are released and recycled. So they obtain the nutrients from the dead animals. When they digest it, the minerals will be released into the environment. So it was, there's a continuous recycle of these mineral salts which are needed by the plants. So it plays a vital role in the environment as they are responsible for decaying. Example of these saprophytic fungi, we have the mushrooms and the mold. Proceeding to the importance of fungi, yeast is useful in the process of fermentation. So we have products which are made from fermentation, products like the beer, the Tusker, it's a well-known brand in Kenya. We have example of wine like the Kingfishers. So you have to remember, drinking is for people who are 18 years old and above. And when you are drinking, you have to drink and drive responsibly. So don't drive under the influence of the drink. So another example of an item that is made using the yeast. Another product which is made using the process of fermentation is the bread, which we use the yeast so that it can be made. So we have an example of our favorite bread, which is called the festive bread here. So the yeast is used mainly in the fermentation industry. That is, it uses the process of anaerobic respiration. That is, oxygen is not needed in this process. So these products are mainly sealed so that the fermentation can take place. So an example, we have the wine, we have beer, we have bread. So these are just among the products. We have cheese, we have the soy sauce, we have vinegar, and we have the yogurts, which are made using this fungi. Proceeding forward, some species of mushroom are used as a source of food. So you have to also take note that there are mushrooms which are very poisonous, and there are mushrooms which can be eaten. So you have to take note if you like to take to eat some of this mushroom. So here is a dish which has been prepared. So these are mushrooms, so they can be, they are edible. Some of them can be eaten. Another importance of fungi. Some fungi are used in the production of several antibiotics. So antibiotics like the penicillins. So they grow naturally in some fruits and some orange. So antibiotic is that drug that you're given when you have a bacterial infection. So there are some fungi which help in the production of these types of drugs. Proceeding forward, there are several fungi which are used in commercial production of different organic products like the citric acid. So citric acid is naturally occurring preservative, which is used in many applications, including canning, flavoring, cleaning, and even photography development. So that is an example of a product which has been made using citric acid. We also have lactic acid, which is also a food preservative and a flavoring agent. We also have fumaric. This is a common food additive which is included in many processed food, and they help to keep the foods stable. Then we also have another product which is made using the fungi. It's called oxalic acid. So this is a household chemical. It can be used for cleaning various things. For example, it is used in removal of rust. It can also be used as a cleaning agent around the homes. It is also used as a bleaching agent. Another importance of fungi, some fungi are used to produce hormone like the gibberellins. So gibberellins is a plant hormone that regulates the growth and influences various development processes. That includes the stem elongation, which means it's the growing of the stem lengthwise, germination of the seed dormancy, flowering in the plants, the sex expression, and the enzyme induction. So the fungi are responsible, they help to produce this plant hormone, which is responsible for all these processes that which we have mentioned here. Another importance of fungi, so now let us look at the harmful effects of fungi. We have looked at the positive side of fungi and how it helps us in our day-to-day life and in other processes. Now let us look at the harmful effects of fungi. The first one, it's responsible for the spoilage of food. So many molds such as rhizopus, mucus, and penicillin, they grow on the bread, jams, and the jellies. So they render the food unfit for human consumption. So when these types of mold grow in the food, you're not supposed to eat this food because some of them might be toxic and it's very unfit for the consumption of anyone. Then they're also responsible for the spoilage of goods around our household and commercial goods. They are attacked by fungi. For example, the clothing, sometimes you might find that you've hung some clothes in a damp or a wet place. So some molds will tend to start developing within where you have hung your clothes. Then they also attack electric goods. So they are attacked mainly by molds. Then there are some yeast which cause huge loss in the silk industry. They attack the silkworms and kill. So there are some fungi which are very harmful. They attack the silkworms, which are responsible for distributing or making the silk. So they will attack this worm. So when they attack this worm, the silk industry will not make any type of silk, so they go on loss. Proceeding forward, another harmful effect of fungi. So some fungi will cause plant diseases, like there are some stems which will rust, especially of the wheat. Then there's what we call the potato blight. When you look at a potato, there are some potatoes that might have some black markings on them, and they're very unfit for consumption. So this type of fungi, they also cause harm, which we call the potato blight. We also have what we call the tomato blight. So those black markings you find at the tomatoes, so it is caused by the fungi. So this is a fungal infection on the plants. So this is among the harmful effects of the fungi. Proceeding forward, there are some which cause diseases in humans. So just to mention a few, we have beriberi, which is, it affects the foot. We have ringworms of the nails. So that's the disease, it's caused by a fungal infection. It affects the nail. We have colitis mycotica, which is it affects the vaginal tract. Then lastly, we have a fungal meningitis, which affects the brain. And our illustration here, it shows a foot rot, which is caused by a fungi. So it's mainly caused when you wear damp and wet socks. So it causes this type of foot rot. It's a fungal infection. So we have to be careful on what we wear and how we conduct ourselves. Another harmful effect of fungi. Some fungi are concerned with the destruction of substances, like some of them can attack the textile materials, the papers, the leather goods, rubber, or even optical instrument. So we have an illustration, our very beautiful shoes, which have been attacked by molds because maybe they have been stored in a moist place or in a damp area. So those green organisms that you see are on the surface of the leaves, those are what we call the fungi. So they are very destructive because they destroy the materials that we have in store. So that has been our lesson for today. And I'm going to leave you with an assignment. And today our assignment is not going to be theoretical, but it's going to be a practical assignment. So what I'll need you to do is, you gather, so we have to gather first the necessary materials which you'll use to grow a mold on a bread. So these are the requirements. You'll need a slice of bread, that is any kind of bread. You'll need a sealed plastic bag, that is a paper bag. Then you'll need a spray of bottle or just some few drops of water. So I note that when you use fresh bread, it will grow mold faster. So try to get a piece of fresh bread. So what are the procedures I need you to do? I need you to spray the bread with water using the spray bottle, or you can just sprinkle using your hands. Then seal the bread in a plastic bag. Thirdly, store the bread in a damp or in a warm area for at least 48 hours. You can extend, but the least you can store this bread is 48 hours. Then I would like you to observe and draw the final product which you have found after getting the bread which you have stored for 48 hours or 48 plus hours. Then lastly, explain why the final product is different and what has led to the formation of that additional organism. So we're going to discuss your findings in our next lesson. I'd like to thank you for listening. You can keep the SMSs coming. You can SMS us on our number, which is 4007. You can write to us. Our Facebook page is Elimu TV. You can also write to us. Our Twitter handle is @Elimu_KE. Thank you for watching. I have been your teacher, Madam Christine Okoth. Keep it Elimu TV.